These mutations keep occurring in nature. This is the nature of the viruses that it keeps happening.
जो नया strain है ये इसमें spread तो ये faster मानी गई है.
This vaccination second phase will start from Monday the next, 1st March 2021, in which anybody above 60 years and 45 plus with comorbidities.
Watching News Epicenter with me, Maria Shakil. India has been an example for many other countries when it comes to tackling the pandemic. But the virus is a tough opponent and continues to be a clear and present danger. As the nation unlocks and expands its vaccination drive, coronavirus cases are surging across 5 states. And now there are more and more signs of mutant COVID strains expanding their presence in the country. 2 new mutated virus strains have been found in Maharashtra, Kerala and Telangana. A total of 187 people have been tested positive for the UK strain, while 6 have been infected with South African variant. So far, there has been 1 reported case of the Brazilian variant of the virus. The centre has rushed teams to states witnessing a surge in cases. The health secretary has written to 7 states and union territories giving advisories on the measures to tackle the rise in cases. The Delhi government has intensified surveillance and has made RT-PCR tests mandatory for those travelling from states with surging cases. Meanwhile, the centre continues to expand the vaccination drive. It has announced that people above the age of 60 and those above the age of 45 with comorbidities will be vaccinated from March 1st. For this ambitious round, 10,000 government and over 20,000 private vaccination centres are being set up. The vaccine will be given free of cost at government centres, while pricing for vaccinations at private centres is under discussion. After over a year of facing off against this pandemic, is India ready to take on this surge while keeping the unlock drive intact? Is our vaccination infrastructure ready to take on these mutant strains and expand the reach to more citizens? Do we need the private sector to enter the fray and help play an active role to shoulder the COVID burden? These are critical questions before the nation, and to answer them, joining me first on the show is government's principal scientific advisor, Professor Vijay Raghavan. Professor Raghavan, appreciate your time. Thank you so much. If the surge is not because of the 2 variants of the virus found among the patients of Maharashtra, Kerala and Telangana, as ICMR is saying, then what really do we know about these 2 strains of coronavirus?
You know, thank you very much. First of all, we must get our terminology okay. As the virus infects people across the world, it undergoes changes, and those changes are called mutations. When multiple mutations occur as it progresses, these mutations occur in what's called a lineage, and that gives rise to a variant. What we're seeing is a variant. When the variant starts having many new properties which distinguish it from what is already present, if those are substantially different, then you have a strain. So a new strain has something which has got definitely new properties. What we are looking at are mutations which are more prevalent in the population. We now have to check whether these have a causal relationship with spread in that region. If they do, then there would be a variant of concern. And if they change a lot, then there would be a strain. So right now, we are seeing mutations, but we're not seeing variants of concern.
So, Professor Raghavan, do we really know then what are we dealing with in the second wave? When pandemic began, the larger sentiment in the scientific community was that we are in an uncharted territory. Are we back in this uncharted territory with these new variants?
We know a huge amount about the biology of the virus, how it affects our population, and how to deal with it. So those are the important learnings over the previous year. Now, as new variants arise, we must keep in mind that, you know, if these are to become variants of concern, we have the tools at hand to deal with that on one side, and we have the tools as individuals to deal with spread on the other. So, for example, we can actually measure in the laboratory now whether variants are variants of concern or not, whether they are vaccine or antibody evasive or not. And if they are, we have the tools to make different vaccines and ramp up speed of testing and deployment. So while, of course, there are matters of concern about potential new variants, we are steadily going into a situation where we can deploy the tools we have learned to attend to them should these concerns arise.
Okay, the PGIMER of Chandigarh is saying that new COVID strains detected in India is highly transmissible, adding we should take precautions to prevent the rise in cases. So are we looking for lockdown of sort exercise again? Because we are seeing partial lockdown in several districts of Maharashtra.
Again, there are multiple components we have to keep in mind. Whether the new variants are more transmissible than the already existing ones or not, we have to see. Secondly, we have to see, are they transmissible despite people already being infected, some people, or being vaccinated? And we don't know the answer to that yet. So the short answer is we must be careful about new variants which come. These are not yet strains which are different, and they are not yet demonstrated to be variants of concern. And therefore, while we take all precautions, there is absolutely no need to think that any of these mutations we're seeing, without having tested them out in multiple ways, are immediately of concern. They could be, we have to be careful, but we must keep in mind that, you know, mutations will arise and we need to test them out.
Okay, so most of these cases are coming from certain states only. For example, 81% of the cases are from Maharashtra. Why is this surge happening only in few states?
So that, of course, the more surge you have in specific location, the more viruses are naturally there. And the more you have viruses, the more variation you will see. So to correlate the variation as the cause of the surge requires multiple steps. We don't know whether that is the cause or not, or whether it is a correlate. And therefore, it's important if there is a second wave or there's a surge happening in some locations or an increased number of cases, we take the fullest measures to deal with that while we try to understand the biology of the virus. It's not correct to blame or impute the biology of the virus as the cause for everything. It may be a cause that needs to be demonstrated, but social and, you know, public health measures need to be primary at this stage.
Okay, then Professor Raghavan, can the approved vaccines in India work for the new strain? Because I'm looking at this study report in Science magazine. It says that new coronavirus variants could cause more infection. So does it mean it requires new vaccines?
No, when people say rightly that something could happen, we must keep in mind that we must interpret that as exactly that. It could happen, but it doesn't mean that it has happened. Right now, as far as we know, the current variants in India are not vaccine evasive. Should there be strains which come in or variants which come in, which are more vaccine evasive, already our scientists in our research laboratories in our industry are working on multiple other vaccines and specifically on vaccines against those variants. And therefore, you know, getting them into deployment will be a much faster process. But again, I would like to reiterate at the same time,
yes,
while that is what scientists and our industry will be doing, we should have very strong focus on COVID appropriate behavior and not open up an area where there are more viruses in the environment.
So then what if, Professor Raghavan, more COVID variants are resistant to vaccines? Because new COVID-19 variant named B.1.525, discovered in 13 countries, is more resistant to existing vaccines.
Right. So they are not resistant to all vaccines. They certainly, you know, seem to be significantly of concern with some vaccines. And very importantly, you know, these numbers which you put in the name of the variant, they tell us also the results of where exactly the mutations are. And therefore, people know why they are vaccine evasive. Mm. And therefore, they can modify the vaccine development slightly so that, you know, these new variants are not vaccine evasive anymore. And those are rapidly all ongoing work everywhere. So, you know, I don't think that from the vaccine development point of view, that we will be in a situation where we are unable to keep catching up should there be changes.
Okay, so
again, I would like to stress, yes, we don't have to be constantly catching up on a huge scale if we simultaneously put other measures to curb the prevalence of viruses in our population.
Okay, last question to you, sir. Can we still think of getting herd immunity now that COVID has become multivariant virus disease?
No, the vaccine does just that. Large-scale vaccination provides the entire community with herd immunity. That's a tried and tested way of herd immunity. And indeed, the term used in vaccination comes from the deployment of vaccines. Now, if you're asking whether you can have herd immunity without vaccines, that is, let people get the disease and therefore they have immunity, that is not and cannot be a conscious mode of doing things. Some people sadly get infected, they go through a moderate amount of trouble or a greater amount of trouble, and they recover and they're protected. But that's not a program of our government, certainly. Vaccination to get, you know, proper herd immunity is the program.
All right, Professor Vijay Raghavan, it was a pleasure to speak to you, sir. Thank you so much for your time here on News Epicenter. Let me bring in my guests now. Dr. D.S. Rana is the Sir Ganga Ram Hospital Chairman. Dr. Anupam Sibbal, Group Medical Director, Apollo Hospitals. Dr. Rahul Pandit, he is the Director, Critical Care, Fortis Hospital, and also member of Maharashtra COVID Task Force. I'm going to begin with you, Dr. Pandit. What's the challenge at hand? Vaccine accessibility or hesitancy?
I think the challenge has been multifold. So there has been a significant amount of vaccine hesitancy initially. And then the question about a second dose just compounded it, when to take the second dose, because the WHO came up with a guideline and recommended that for Covishield, we can sort of take the vaccine between 8th and 12th week and the efficacy will be better. And that's what added on to these healthcare professionals sort of thinking twice before taking up the second dose. So that has been one of the issues. The other issue has been initial glitches, at least in Maharashtra, about the COVID app, but I think those things have been sorted out. I don't think there has been a vaccine accessibility issue for this first phase, which is going on. But what is rightly been done now, and the announcement which has come up from the Honorable Minister this afternoon, is extremely positive and welcome step. And I really look forward to have the 30,000 vaccination centers, 10,000 public and 20,000 private, been activated over the month or so. Because if each of these are able to vaccinate 100 people, we will have approximately 30 lakh people vaccinated every day. And if they work 5 days a week, this 30 crore target seems to be suddenly possible now. Hmm. And I think that's a very, very welcome and a much needed announcement which has happened.
Okay, Dr. Sibbal, come in on this. Help us understand what will be the nature of this public-private partnership. The government is saying very clearly that as far as those who will be going to these private, public 10,000 centers, the government centers, then the vaccines will be given free of cost. The government will be bearing the cost. But for those 20,000 private hospitals or private centers, the individual will have to bear the cost. What will be the nature of this partnership?
Good evening, Mara. Thank you for having me on your show. First of all, I think we in the private sector welcome the announcement that came in close on the heels of what the Prime Minister said yesterday about public-private collaboration. And then what Prakash Javdekar ji said today, that we are going to go from 2,000 to 20,000 on the private sector.
Yes.
Now, this is a 10 times increase, which just goes to show that the government has a lot of faith in the private sector being able to deliver in vaccine administration. So what will this collaboration look like? We await details from the government. We believe that there are some discussions going on in terms of allowing access to individuals to choose their private facility, or will it be based on where they live? Will it be just dependent on COVID, or will it have Arogya Setu, or will there be a third mechanism? Till now, it was linked to Aadhaar cards, but we are being given to understand that there might be an option of using other form of ID, which of course the individual must carry with him or her when they go to the vaccine center. So there are a few guidelines that we await, but from the private sector point of view, I think we are very happy that the government has shown this confidence. Okay. Because clearly, right since March, it has been a collaboration, whether it's in testing or ICU beds or, yes, or treatment. So we welcome this, and we will be able to scale up. Okay. The private sector has been planning this for a while.
Yes.
Many of us have thought about how we will increase
the
capacity.
I'm going to ask you about that capacity in just a bit. Let me get a quick word also from Dr. Rana. Dr. Rana, over 1 crore 20 lakh people vaccinated ever since the exercise began on 16th of January. There has been a lot of excitement with which it began, but then at the same time, we saw some reports coming from certain corners of vaccine hesitancy. There were also concerns raised about the pace of vaccination. The view of several experts has been that given the size of our population, it's important to be cautious initially and then scale up and bring private players, as the government has decided now. What do you see are the immediate challenges that will be which can appear if this is the scale at which the government plans to expand from 1st of March?
I think it is a very welcome move that the 30,000 center will be delivering this, and they will be taking place in the vaccination drive. And this will be a very big boost. And I think the government has already realized that private sector can play important role in this drive. And this is a very pragmatic approach otherwise also. People of upper class and middle class, they are very willing to pay, but they want hassle-free process. And as Dr. Anupam Sibri told that as far as ID is concerned, so far we were very adamant on PAN cards and all those things. If that can be made a little hassle-free, then we will achieve our target, and also it will release the burden, financial burden, on the government actually.
So the 30 crore target that the government is hoping to have achieve by August, Dr. Sibal, is something that they are hoping that they will be able to achieve with this kind of scale up. Help us understand, what does it entail in terms of 20,000 centers? What all can they follow, all the precautions that has been taken till now?
Myra, absolutely. The guidelines that the government issued in January, the 154-page booklet, was very well written. It was very practical. It was user-friendly. And that's what all hospitals, government or private, have followed for more than a month. So I think the protocol is very clearly laid out. All this means is that each one of us has to build capacity. For example, in one of our hospitals in Hyderabad, on one single day, we were able to vaccinate hundreds of healthcare workers when the vaccine was provided. So it's a question of scaling up. You know, the protocol is very clear. You do the ID, and then you administer, and then you wait for 30 minutes after the vaccine to look for side effects. So the more people you have who are trained to administer the vaccine, and that you have physical infrastructure, which is not very hard to build, we can actually scale up in a very short period of time and scale up like never before. So I think we are all very excited about.
But it also requires experienced ANMs, yes, the training that happened before the vaccination program started, and then this sudden scaling up that is going to happen. So what will be the role of private players then? Are your nurses, doctors really prepared for this?
Myra, all doctors, are very comfortable in vaccinating, as are nurses, and they do this every day. So it's a question of having studied that the side effects aren't really there. All you get is mild soreness or, a bit of discomfort or fever. So there's nothing really to worry about there. But the staff is trained to manage should there be a more serious reaction. So let's just demystify this for a minute. It's a vaccine that has to be administered, right? And we've been vaccinating for decades.
But this is an adult vaccination program, very different from what we are used to.
The flu vaccine is an adult vaccine. The pneumococcal vaccine is an adult vaccine. The cervical cancer vaccine is an adult vaccine.
Okay.
Sometimes hepatitis B is given to adults. The shingles vaccine is an adult vaccine. So there are numerous examples of adult vaccines that have been given. Yes, the size and the scale of a vaccination program, which traditionally is for infants and children, is now moved on to the adults because we know why. So I think the basic principles remain the same. And I think there has been adequate training and preparation. And I personally believe, and I say this on behalf of my colleagues across the spectrum, that we will be able to come good on this challenge that I think all of us need to overcome. We have a window of opportunity. We don't want the numbers to keep rising. We want to be able to vaccinate as many people as we can very quickly so that the advantage that India has of vaccines. Remember, Myra, we have the advantage of vaccines. Many countries in the world are struggling to get vaccines.
We are, in fact, sending vaccines to our neighbors as well. So that is also vaccine diplomacy, which is playing out. Dr. Rana, you get the final words. You know, the fact is that India made gains in terms of its COVID management. Our recovery rate is one of the highest in the world. It has been phenomenal the way the entire COVID management has been under Prime Minister Narendra Modi. Help us understand, from the surge that we saw, the second surge also happening in Delhi, and then the manner in which it has been managed, and now the next step of those who are above the age of 60 getting vaccinated.
I think right from the beginning, all people followed, our nation followed the advice of our government, advisory, and we were strict. In between there was some laxity, and that led to surge, you know. But our concerted efforts were able to bring success, and we were able to achieve the success non-comparable to any country, actually. And I am very sure that, as Anupam told, there will be no challenge as far as we are all excited for in this vaccination drive, and we will be able to achieve this drive. And there, the hesitancy of not getting vaccination will be also very much less now. Every day is passing, hesitancy is going off, actually. So I think we will achieve our drive to achieve herd immunity very, very shortly now.
On that very, very positive note, thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Rana, Dr. Sibyl, and Dr. Pandit. Thank you so much for joining us. Of course, the second phase of vaccination drive, the world's biggest vaccination drive in a country of as big as ours, is beginning from first, when those who are above the age of 60 and those who have comorbidities and around the age of 45 will be vaccinated. That remains our top focus here on CNN News 18. That's all from me. I'll be seeing you tomorrow. Thanks so much for watching.